Well, what we have here is a late 2009 iMac 27-inch with i7 processor running at 2.8 GHz. This Mac has served me fairly well, although one of its biggest problems is what this video is all about, the graphics card. The graphics card actually failed just after, I'm talking about a month after the 3-year AppleCare expired. I wrote Tim Cook, and he nicely arranged an executive in my part of the world to contact me. We discussed the issue and all said they swapped out the video card, which repaired the problem. Unfortunately, it's now a few years later, and actually it was about 3 years after that replacement that the same sort of thing started happening, meaning artifacts on the screen and so on. So what we're going to see in this video is how to repair the problem. So what we need to do to open everything up is to lay it on a soft surface. And in my case, the biggest soft surface I had other than the floor is a bed. So I just put it here on the bed. We have to take out the RAM first because we're going to be disassembling it and taking out the main board. So we need to remove the RAM first and foremost before anything else. To take out the RAM, we have to access at the base of the iMac, just above here is the foot, and we have three Phillips, or you can call them plus, screws that need to be removed. I have my trusty screwdriver here to do that. And again, we need to do this before any other steps, because we have to take out, unfortunately, the entire logic board to get to the video card. This isn't too difficult. This is the only set of regular screws that we're going to be taking out. The rest will need to be taken out with a Torx. So if you don't have a Torx, you won't be able to do this. You need a Torx T10 for the other screws. And of course, we have plenty of dust bunnies. After you've used your iMac a while, even in a clean environment, you're still going to have something like this. So we need to clean this up. At least I want to do it before I take out the RAM. And here we are with a little brushing off with a tissue. It's not pristine, but clean enough to my satisfaction to remove the RAM. Now to do that, we've got these little black flaps in here that aid us in removing the RAM. And it's really fairly simple. We just pull on it. Boom. And boom. We can pull it out. And we see here that we have an 8 GB SIM, or DIM, followed by another 8 GB for a total of 16 GB in this iMac. I should also mention that I have a static dissipator on my wrist here. This guy will make sure that static charges are not going to go from my body into sensitive electronic components like RAM and destroy them. So you want to make sure that your body is grounded somehow before you start touching the electronics. You could say, all right, touching them by the edge, you know, like this, maybe that will help to avoid it if you don't have any way to ground yourself. But I wouldn't advise that, just because static discharges can leap, especially, you know, from within a millimeter or two from your finger to those contacts, it can leak. So you jump anyway. So you want to make sure that you don't destroy something in the process of trying to fix it. So RAM is removed. Now we go to the next step of removing the front glass. So now we're going to need to take off the glass. I've got my suction cups on there. If you don't have these, stop what you're doing and buy them. Okay? There's other approaches. Other people may give you other ways of doing it. But look. If you've got a plus screw, a Phillips head screw, are you going to use a minus driver? I'm sure some of you have tried it, but it's best to use a plus driver. In the same way, get the proper tools. iFixit.com, I borrowed these from a friend. They're ubiquitous, and I live in Japan. You know, they're pretty much in everyone's pocket, just about, so you can borrow them or buy them just about anywhere. Get these suction cups. They've got a little lever here that adjusts and lets you affix it to the glass, and it really sticks on there strong. It's not just your average suction cup. This works really well. Now, the glass has magnets around the side, and what we're going to do is pull it off. Now, the bottom here has little pieces sticking out, so we can't pull this straight up. We have to pull this stuff up, this part of the glass up, and then push it out, and then we can take off the whole sheet of glass. I laid the iMac down here on the bed so that the weight of the machine is going to help me. If I was standing it up on the foot, then it would pull over, right? It would fall over. So here I'm going to just pick up and pull out and see how easy that was. With the front glass off, we now have to remove Torx screws. And I see 1, 2, 3, 4, another 4 on the other side. There's screws along the top, but these are the magnets in here. So we need to remove these screws before we can do anything else. And I'll zoom in so you can see. And here's the bottom left-hand corner. You can see that right there. So that's just one of the 4 on each side. Now I've taken out the screws on both sides, and you can pull off the screen with it laying down here on the bed like I'm doing it, or you can stand it up. If you stand it up, it might even be a little bit easier, but basically you want to have a tool that applies the leverage under here. Just leave it in there and then get another tool and then go on the opposite side and then leverage it. There are magnets here, so it sticks. Just make sure that your tool doesn't flop onto this screen. This is the actual LCD. You don't want to hurt this. I've got the upper left corner of the iMac screen propped up here so that you can see one of the cables that we have to disconnect, which is this blue-tipped cable right here. And it's a ribbon cable, so you have to be very careful, but basically we slide it towards the top to pull it out. And there it is. So to put it back in, we do not want to put it back in with the pins facing up. We want to have the blue facing towards the screen. So now you're looking top down, and we've got 3 connectors that we need to take care of. This one is kind of tough because it's got a little flap here. You have to take it with your thumbnail and put your thumbnail there and pull it towards the monitor while pushing down. And then we can get it out. So that's one of them. And then over here, we have a small, tiny little connector that there are other small, tiny connectors around it. So you have to be careful to mark it and get it back, but basically this one pulls up. Okay. And it has a gray and black wire. The black wire goes to the right, the gray goes to the left, to make sure you don't turn it around the wrong way when you put it back in again. It's probably keyed, but it's small. The metal contacts are on the other side, and they would face towards the display, and that's how it goes in right here. And then we have another cable here, which right out. That was pretty easy. Alright, so now it seems like all the cables are out, so I should be able to lift up and out. Let's try it. We want to avoid getting fingerprints on the screen, if at all possible. And here is the iMac in all of its glory, with the LCD removed. Now, I want to point out that I've labeled everything. This is 1, 2, 3. Those are the three connectors that are required to be removed in order to pull out, completely remove, the LCD. And so I've marked those. Just some other things to note. This guy here is the power supply. You don't want to lay your hands on him. He might still be charged. There's some big capacitors there that hold the charge for a while. The hard drive normally goes here. And what you're seeing there is not the stock hard drive. I put a Samsung EVO 850 1TB SSD in there. By the way, if you really want your 2009 computer to feel like something in 2015, 16, or 17 era, you really need to have an SSD. And this SSD is compatible. It's just, it requires a couple options you have to buy from OWC, MacSales.com, Otherworld Computing, including this bracket, which I bought from them, which includes this standoff, and this guy, which is perhaps the most important thing. The interface for the temperature sensor of the hard drive, so that the fans won't be always spinning full blast, and you don't need any software, special fan control software to deal with. It's all done for you in this little hardware module there. So I got the Samsung SSD off Amazon. I've got the mounting bracket and the temperature controller from Otherworld Computing. You might be able to get the bracket from, and even the temperature sensor from Amazon if you look around. It just depends on what prices you find acceptable. The next step, of course, is, our main purpose for even opening this, is to deal with the video card. And the video card is over here. Now, how are we going to get to that? Well, we have to remove the motherboard. Well, what's the motherboard include? Well, the motherboard includes all of what you see here. All of this has to be taken out, and that's not a lot of fun, but that's what we're going to do now. Just before we remove the screws, I should mention that number 2 here, it says LCD temp, so the LCD temperature connector. That is what it says in white silk screen there. I'm going to zoom in a little bit so you can see it better. Maybe you can see that LCD temp there, and then next to that, we've got a gray and black guy here. You can see the pins go towards you, and on the back side it's all black. So when you put it back in, you don't put it plastic side towards you, you put it pin side towards you. Taking this guy out, which it says here on here, APN 593 1037 Revision A Vendor LW, it's the AW B temp. That is that particular one. And then we have to take out this one. Okay, pin side towards you. Alright. This comes out of this deep hole in here. It just says BT up there. This one, pin side towards you, says camera. So camera's up higher up there. Then we take out this one. It says HDD fan, hard disk drive fan. Okay, so this one here, hard disk drive fan, these are a set of 4 black wires, whereas these other connectors here have different colored wires in there. And then that goes, this wire goes in front of this red-black twisted cable, and if I take out this, the pin side towards you again, and this white connector says HDD temperature, which, of course, if you follow it up, it goes to that temperature sensor there. And then, of course, we have this last one here, which is black and gray, very small connector here, and it says skin temperature. Obviously not my skin, but the aluminum frame, I would assume, of the iMac itself. So in total, 1... two, three, four, five, six, seven connectors, plus this one here that I haven't fiddled with yet, and it comes right off. That should be fairly easy and intuitive to put back on there. But eight, and that's a little bit too small to read. So eight connectors up here in this top row, plus more that I will show you now. And when you get it all labeled, assuming you're as meticulous as I am, it's like this. I labeled the connector number five, and of course, with male and female, five and five. So this five goes to this five, this four goes to this four, and so on. And that should make it pretty simple to deal with without thinking too hard. But now we have some more connectors over here in this bottom area that we need to look at. You've got to just pull these to the right. This connector looks an awful lot like this one, so we want to make sure that we mark them. They are different sizes, so you wouldn't be able to mix them up, but nevertheless, might as well just label them. Right speaker says left speaker, right speaker, left speaker, which is the built-in speakers. Then we have this one here, which says mic connector for the microphone. And this one says SD, the SD card. And then we have this flat, dusty, dirty cable down here, which says RMTIO. And I'm not sure the best way to take him out. Slowly with the fingernails, maybe. Yes, that was the best way. So that got him. Wow! More connectors underneath that. And there's these guys, which is ODD fan. And down here, ODD temperature. The bottommost right. In all, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So just another 7 connectors in this area alone. And we're still not done, by the way. Hard to believe, we've got 17 connectors already removed and there's still more, but yes, there's more! Over here, on this side, we've got a couple over here. Now we have to CPU fan here, and then we've got IR here. So here they are labeled. There was actually one more hiding down here, the power button, which of course is on the back over here, on the back side of the computer. There's, I have them all labeled 20, so there are 20 total connectors that we have here on this board. Connector 20 is the IR, 18 is CPU fan, and number 19 is again the power button. Oh my. So as you can see, we got labels galore. So many connectors. Apple, you'd think you'd figure out how to cut down this manual labor or assembly on putting together these computers. That's a lot of manual labor putting. I'm sure they don't have robots putting them in there. Somebody's hand physically put them all in. So now the screws. As if that wasn't bad enough, we have to deal with screws. And we don't want to take away all the screws because some of the screws mount the heat sinks to the board and we don't want to take those off now. I do see over here there is some decision making that we're going to have to do. With regard to which of these, I guess this leftmost screw. Maybe take him out of here, and that should allow separation at this point. Although I suppose you could take away this one, or even both if you really wanted to. That one's a doozy. That one's a big one. So the big one, the long one, he goes here, down here in the bottom left corner there. That's also the same type. Same type. This one looks different. This one is different than the other two I just took out. The other two are a little bit longer. So this guy, which was taken out down here next to my number 17, this guy is just a little bit shorter. This guy is also one of the short ones. Just like I just removed, they're both of the same length. So the two down here are not short screws, but they're shorter than these two. We're going to have some in the top, in the upper area over here, that we're going to have to take care of. And it would appear there's a screw up here, but I think it's this guy that I need to take care of. He's a small one. Alright, I found another screw behind my label 14. My label 14 is here. Temporarily take him off and get this screw out. And this guy is of the longer variety. So he is matching first couple screws I took out here and here. So here, here, and here, those three screws are all the same longer length. Alright, I found another screw here. It's this guy. There's actually a little down arrow kind of pointing to him being important. So we'll take him out. This guy is the same length as the first screws I took out. So this guy, and then the one behind the label 14 over here, all of them were of the longer variety. And so now, if I pull, you can see it starts to come out now. So let me. It seems like I'm having a difficult time to remove because there's some kind of connector or slot that it's in down here. Well, this is the horrid part. It cost me an hour of time. This part is the casing for the ambient light sensor. And this has to be pulled out. Pulled out before you can remove the logic board. How much time I wasted trying to get this thing out. I had to pry it out with, somebody said it was spring-loaded. I'm sorry, but I don't see any springs, and pushing down on it didn't spring and pop it up. Whoever said that's crazy. And that was iFixit, actually. This guy. Oh, the grief it caused me. So now that it's out, I should be able to get the motherboard out. Before I do that, there are yet more connectors on the other side that we still have to take off before we can get it out. Apple, what do you think of all these connectors? So it looks like three more. One down here, another one right next to it, and then a little tiny one here. Three more that have to be removed. And with three removed, this is what we have. So we have the little connector here, and then this guy goes here, and then the big guy a little bit farther down. So those are the three connectors. Now yet another connector. Well, I'll be darned. This big one back there. Finally, I get it off. Here's the logic board finally removed from the iMac. The label side, of course, the side facing you after you take the screen off. The video card is here with its heatsink. The CPU heatsink is here. You've got the RAM here. So we'll flip him. Now, once again, this guy is our GPU, the graphics card, that's giving us a problem. Here's our CPU and its heatsink. And we've got a little clock battery here as well. Since I have it out, I might as well replace that guy. And then over here, all the ports, your Ethernet and USB, and so on. So the next step is to get the card out of this heatsink. You got two Torx here. Most of these Torxes are T10s. I've been using a T9 to take them all out. T9 is what I have, and it works a little bit loose, but it works. And these are teensy tiny little screws here. Be careful not to lose them. All right. So these are spring-loaded screws. I don't know if I'm supposed to take them all the way out, but I need to be careful I don't break off this temperature sensor here. I don't know, so I guess I just need to take it off. So many things to put back together. These screws look like the same length as the others I took off, so I won't have to worry about placement. Now it's coming apart. Yes. I guess at this point I can slide it out. Yes. Okay. I have to remove these here. These are a different size. You have to remember that. These are longer than the other ones that just the other Torx that just came off. Okay. All the rest of it, keep unscrewing it, I guess. Okay. That seems to have done it. And there is the card. The card of sorrows. The card of much woe. The card that made me do all of this work, hopefully not in vain. And I need to, before I bake this card, take off this, whatever it is, this little soft thingy which is taped on. Okay, so the little tab sticking out, it went that way, AMD. All right, I got it. Next thing, I'm going to have to clean off the paste before putting it in the oven. Here's a close-up of the graphics card on the back side, which, of course, does not have any heatsink paste on it. And then on the front side, after cleaning with dehydrated ethanol on the main chip, and of course on these memory chips, and this also had a little paste on it too. So 4, 8, 9, 10 total chips that had paste. And I used about 10 swabs with my alcohol to get it off. And this, there was a lot of paste in between these parts here. I don't think it's conductive paste, so it doesn't matter so much, perhaps. But anyway, it's all clean now, and now it's time for the oven. Oven preheated 200 degrees Celsius. It's going to be in there for 9 minutes. Some people said 8, some people said 10, so I'm going to take the average. That's 9. So the aluminum foil is there to keep it suspended and have heat go underneath it. And I put it on under the four screw holes so it wouldn't touch the components, at least not too much on the bottom. So the last few seconds of the 9 minutes here. Alright, now we can take them out. Let it cool down first before we take it out to avoid any thermal shock. Well, the card has been baked for 9 minutes and I'm letting it cool. While I do that, you can see the bottom of the heat sink. I've cleaned it. I haven't cleaned off all of these just because I don't have enough paste to restore this. So I have a little bit of the of this kind of paste. It's it says heatsink silicone compound, and this is non-conductive. And then I have some Arctic Silver 5. The Arctic Silver 5 is conductive. So I have to be careful not to spill the Arctic Silver 5. I plan to put that on the main chip, which is going to be the hottest one. That's why this is copper, right? So I'm going to use the Arctic Silver 5 in this area. I'm going to put that directly on the chip, not on here. And then I will put some of this white compound on these four chips, and then this little, I guess it's a coil, this part here. Interestingly, it seems like there's almost a millimeter and a half of height here. You wouldn't think that you'd want it to be this thick on the memory chips. And look, you can see where it wasn't quite filled in there either. So I'm wondering, was it really the chip that was a problem, or not just bad heat dissipation to the heat sink on these other places? I'm not really sure, but I'll try to remedy it the best I can. Okay, the graphics card is cooled down now, so I will start applying my heatsink compound a little bit at a time to these, I guess they're memory chips. Hopefully I have enough because this is all I have. And I will spread that around a little bit more before I'm done. Got a little thing here I can spread it with. And again, this white stuff is, it's silicon, it's non-conductive, so even if it spills over on the sides of the chip, it's not going to cause problems. I just have to be careful with the Arctic Silver. It'd be better if I maybe use this on here, but this is inferior to the Arctic Silver. The Arctic Silver is better, so it's more conductive. It does have real silver in it. Okay, so there's those. Now for my Arctic Silver on the main chip, which is something I need to be careful with. Around the sides of the chip, it seems to be sealed. So even if it spills over a little bit, it's okay, but I'm worried about these tiny capacitors. I don't want it to short them out, because again, this is real silver, and but it's good stuff. I will just give it a try. Let me spread it around. So I got it there. Now, maybe just apply a little bit on the heatsink side as well. Now apply just a tad bit more Arctic Silver right in the middle. Okay. I forgot to put on my little black thingy here. I should have probably done that for the application of heatsink compound, but oh well. Unsurprisingly, the tape doesn't want to stick. It's gotten so hot over the years. But it will go down when I put on the top. I'm going to put these two on. Probably best to line up the holes. I wish that would stick. Holes. Oh, this is going to be fun. That silly black thing there. This thing will not stick. And it's bothering me. I don't even know if it's really that important. Probably just gonna get in the way. So it doesn't matter. There's some indenting here and nothing here and here. So it doesn't seem to matter which way it comes back on. That one is not screwing in. Why not? Maybe because it screws into the screws on the other side? Possibly. Maybe these screws have to be screwed down for the bottom screws to screw into it. I'm going to assume that's what it is for. Maybe? I don't know. Oh, not that. It's Torx. Yeah, now it's screwing down. Well, the question is how much pressure? And now we put the frame back on. And there's a tiny screw here that goes in this location to secure it. And then we have two more screws here and here. Wasn't sure how tight these should go. They have little coils around them. I tightened them as tight as they would go without giving it all my might. I just kept screwing and screwing until it about stopped. And so it's firm, but not too tight. Perhaps it's just right. I'm not sure what it's supposed to be. The tightness level, I mean. I'm putting it back into the motherboard slot. This frame goes on the other side. This connector goes in this slot. That's as far as it will go. And this little guy and again that is the heat sensor connector here. Back in our three screws. They're all the same length. Before I put back in the logic board, I just wanted to point out that I took a vacuum cleaner and cleaned out the fans. What you're looking at now is the left side fan at the bottom area. And I actually unscrewed. There's two screws. You can see them there on the left and at the right near the wires. Just two screws, and it pops right out. And there's actually a lot of gunk, not only in the fan itself, but below where it's perforated, where there's the holes are, the air intake. And to keep everything running as cool as possible, it's best to unblock those. And so I cleaned up this fan. And I cleaned up this fan. This is the fan that's on the right side, just beneath the optical drive. I didn't take out this one. It's a little bit, seems like a little bit smaller one, and it didn't have a lot of gunk on it, so I took a little paintbrush and had the vacuum cleaner there, and that was the easy way to take care of it. There's also another fan right in the middle. This is the middle fan. And actually, this fan pulls air directly from the back. If you look at the back of the Mac, there's some there's holes there. It's near the foot area, and that's where it pulls its air in, and cools down the center portion of the Mac. So I took my paintbrush again, and I didn't have to take out this fan. I didn't see it was necessary. I just did the paintbrush and the vacuum and cleaned it right up. And of course, all along the bottom, that's the perforated place where the air intake comes in. This is one other thing I wanted to show just before putting the logic board back in. This is the video card and its heatsink here. It may be difficult for you to see, but there's a gap between the PCB here, circuit board, and the heatsink. And this gap is a little bit more narrow than over here. And I tried adjusting the four screws, but this side would not be exactly the same gap as this, which has me concerned a little bit. It's not because there's existing heatsink paste that won't press down. It's not that. I can actually press down on it with my fingers, and it will go down a little bit. So I don't know if it's warped or what, but it's only very slightly different. But nevertheless, I can see notice the difference with my naked eye, and has me a little bit concerned. But again, there's nothing I can do to make it more secure. So if some of you watching this video have done this yourself, I'm not sure if you can remember how yours looked, but I don't know if mine is unique or not. Nevertheless, I just noticed that the gap here is smaller than the gap here. The gap here is a little bit wider for some reason. One last thing I should mention before putting the logic board back in is the little button cell battery BR2032. This is not CR2032. This is the battery holder. You can see I've got the battery removed there. And I checked the, as you may expect, it's been a number of years since I purchased this 2009 iMac. I'm making the video here in February 2017. So the battery is not new. And as you may expect, we've got some low voltage on it. So it's not 3.0 volts. It's a bit low. It's probably best to change it. The thing is, though, with these batteries, the BR and the CR, what's the difference? Doing a little Googling, I found that the BR battery that's supposed to be in this iMac is rated for minus 40 degrees Celsius to plus 80. The CR series, not BR, but CR, which is the exact same size as this, 2032, is rated only up to 60 degrees Celsius. And since this computer gets pretty hot, it's best to replace this with a BR series rather than a CR series. And none of the stores carried the BR, so I had to order it online. Now I have to wait for it to arrive so I can put it in this circuit board, which is a real pain. And again, another Apple design flaw, if we can call it that. What you're looking at here is the back side of the logic board. This is the back. This side of the logic board faces in, which means in order for you to change the battery, you have to remove the entire logic board like this. Now, obviously, you're not going to be doing that very often, and Apple wants you to buy a new computer as often as possible, so they made it pretty annoying to change the battery. It's not necessary, really, to have it in that if you leave it connected and you know, sleeping most of the time, then you're not going to lose that memory there. But since I've already got the logic board out, I went and ordered a BR2032 battery to replace it. So once that arrives, probably tomorrow, then I'll be able to put that in, and then finally put in the logic board, and then we can see if the oven cooking at 200 degrees Celsius fixed the problem with the GPU like so many people are saying. Well, the new battery finally arrived, and check its voltage. You can see it's considerably higher than the old battery. And placing in the new battery, just pop him right in. Yet one more thing I should mention, the part that gave me the greatest grief during this disassembly was the little light sensor, the ambient light sensor. It just slides over like this. Now I can't put it on now and then put the logic board back in. What I'm going to have to do is keep it removed, then put the logic board in, and once the logic board is in, then I will slide it on so it fits like so. And then, of course, this connector goes right there. There's some wires that have to be in front, and there's a few in the back. There's one of them that I took off before I actually pulled out the logic board, and that's actually, I can put that in now. That's the temperature sensor connector that goes into the GPU graphics card heatsink. So I've already connected that. But there are still other connections that need to be made. There's this big main power connector that needs to be connected here, and then there's two other connectors that have to go in. And we can start by putting in these two, and then slowly putting the logic board back in, making sure to get all of the other important connectors in front so that I don't secure it with any hidden behind. Then all of our cables out here, 19 goes to 19, 18 goes to 18, 4 to 4, 6 and 7 are here. Here's 9, 5 goes over here, so 8, 8 is here, 8, we said we already had 9, 10, this cable here, of course the yellow 2, 3, and 1 are from the screen. I also forgot to label this one up here, but this one too is from the screen, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 go to the screen. So those are not labeled, labeled, and then labeled here. And then we've got, here's 11 and 12, which go here and here. 15, 16, 17, 15, 16, 17 down there. 14, 13, 14, 13. And then we have 20, which after I put the screws in, then I'll put this one in. So we've got everything in, and I can see that the screw holes here and at the top line up. Now it's time to put back in the screws. I've got them laid out all in the order where they should go back. The two shortest screws, one goes here. The other on the far end on the right goes up here. The longest screws are 1, 2, 3, 4. And those go in 1, 2, 3, and then behind my label 14, 4. And then we have two, which are middle-sized screws. These two screws are a little bit shorter than these four. And that goes in near my number 17 here, and then just directly below the fan. So we will put these in now. Have to be careful, though, because if you drop these, I don't have a magnetized Torx here, and these screws do fly, so be careful, otherwise if you lose them behind this board, you'll have to dig it out again, and boy, what a mess that'll be. I'm not going to tighten it too much, just a little bit. This one in here. This one here. Here. And then behind 14. Now we can give them all a bit more tightening. And now we can put back our connectors. And this connector is different than these. These go down, and this one goes straight in. And now, 20 is the ambient light sensor. And the wires were under that tape. So now it's just a matter of putting the screen back on. Now you don't want to touch the screen with your hands, so I'm holding it firmly by the edges. And again, we've got 1, 2, 3, 4 total connectors that we need to put back. Like the most difficult one may be the one at the very bottom, which is the skinny tiny one, which goes here. Last one will be the top left. So now the tricky one. It's difficult to know if it's connected. That's a hard one. I can't tell if it's in there or not, so we'll just have to power it on and see how it goes. And this little guy, blue facing me, pins facing back. Don't need to put on the outer glass. Plug it in, fire it up, see what happens. Well, I got it plugged in, but I haven't even hit the power switch yet, and it's giving me these beeps. Well, the beeping was due to my failure to put in the RAM. Now that the RAM is in, no more beeps, and I didn't even push the power button. It just automatically powered on. And we'll see if it boots. Now that I've confirmed proper operation, or at least no screen artifacts, and for the few minutes I had it booted, it worked. So I think it's safe now to screw down the screen and put back on the glass. This, again, is not a trivial task because you're fighting these magnets all along the way. And so, I mean, the magnets, they help a little bit in that you're probably not going to lose your screws inside the case. Maybe not, because the magnets will hopefully latch onto them. But nevertheless, it is possible. So, here we go. Don't scratch the screen. Don't touch the screen. I managed not to touch the screen. I've seen some other people put on gloves and deal with it. If you think you're going to touch the screen, you obviously need to put on whatever gloves you need. Rubber gloves or so on. But, this is not magnetized. If you've got a magnetized Torx, that's what I would recommend. Because this is going to be a bit of a challenge here. This is actually a T9. I have a T10. It's kind of an Allen wrench style. Maybe it'll hold it in there better so I can actually get it in the hole. Thank you. This one spins forever. So here we have the hardest part, perhaps, of all. Because it's all about the screen. You don't want to have dust on this screen. You don't want to have dust underneath the glass. So I have to clean off both very carefully. And I don't have a clean room, right? There's going to be dust floating around here. I mean, I've got my Giotto patented blower, which does an amazing good job. I didn't touch the screen, so there's no fingerprints for me to worry about. I don't need to use cleaner on it. I used an anti-static cleaner on the back side of the glass, and I'll need to blow it off with this. But even one speck of dust, it could be like a dead pixel, how it looks to you. And so that's really the thing I hate about dealing with these Macs, perhaps most of all, is that how are you going to get rid of all of the dust? So I won't show you all the details of that, but basically it's going to be me with this guy, my suction cups, and putting the glass back on. And here it is, the iMac with the glass on. Taking me about an hour before I finally got pretty much all the dust out and was able to put it on. I've been running it for well over an hour, and no problems at all. I booted it several times, updated some things, rebooted. No problems with the boot sequence anymore. No vertical or horizontal stripes. No blocks appearing on the screen. It truly appears that the oven bake solved a problem. I ran Geekbench. This is the latest version of Geekbench here, 4.04. And I ran the CPU test, and you can see the results there. Multi-core and single-core scores. The compute benchmark, which runs GPU, it recognizes my ATI 4850, but it won't. They didn't manage to put together a test that I could run on it, but I've got Cinebench here, which is the latest version. Unfortunately, the people who make Cinebench aren't very brilliant. They've got this string resource can't be found error, but the solution is show package contents, open up contents, and then open up Mac OS, and then load the app from there, which is a ridiculous workaround, but it's the only way to run it. OpenGL is the benchmark for the GPU, the graphics video card processor, and so it's going to run that now, and it's showing that I have an Intel Core i7 CPU 8660. This is the 2.8 gigahertz version, and it's also showing on the left hand side my ATI Radeon HD 4850 with the OpenGL engine there. So the temperature, I've got a little temperature readout up here. 27 degrees that's the CPU temperature there. The fan speed is about 1300 RPM. Again, I've been running it for about an hour, and I just checked the GPU temperature was about 39 degrees. It's pretty cool in the wintertime here right now. The room is fairly cold, so but the temperature of the GPU itself is not excessive. So I finished running the test, and 40 frames per second. You know, this is a 2009 computer. It's not the most cutting edge machine in the world, so no surprises there. Overall, I'm very pleased. I owe a lot of thanks to Evan here, at Creative Tets for this Burn the VGA and Fix Your iMac video. He was the inspiration. I saw other videos, but I really preferred his. And so thank you, Evan, for creating your video. You showed me how to fix your 27-inch iMac, and it worked. The Evan Bake amazingly worked. So the reason I made a video is just to document everything for myself in the future. Should it happen again, I've got everything that I need to know recorded. And, of course, for all of you who are watching, so that you can see exactly what to do in great detail. So obviously I'm going to need to keep running it, and should there be any problems that crop up over the next few days, weeks, or months, then I'll of course report that in the description under this video. But so far the screen is beautiful, everything is back to working order again, and it really does look like baking it in the oven. Melted the solder balls under the GPU chip sufficiently to fix the intermittent connection problem that clearly had developed over time, and no doubt will unfortunately probably happen again. Hopefully not anytime within the next 3 years, though. Once every 3 years, I guess, we have to go through this. So again, I hope this is helpful to all of you who are watching. And best wishes, and thanks for watching.